Cognitive dissonance. Cognitive dissonance happens to all of us. We're going to talk about it for a little bit here. Cognitive dissonance is a motivation to reduce tension that you feel when your attitude and your behavior are at odds with one another. You ever do something that you felt was really against your beliefs and it made you feel weird to do it because it wasn't consistent with what you felt or what you believed? People do it all the time. They're put in positions in all manner of situations, as we'll see, that make us behave in ways that aren't consistent with our beliefs or our values. So cognitive dissonance, and we're going to see some of the research behind it, is a motivation to alleviate that discomfort that happens when you are acting in such a way as to be at odds with your attitudes, values, or beliefs. The classic example is cigarette smoking. Cigarette smoking is known now. It wasn't known in the 30s and the 40s and the 50s to cause cancer. It's now known to be a risk factor for all manner of health problems. But that was absolutely not known in the early 20th century. It became known and covered up in the late 20th century. And now there's no question about it, but people still smoke. Anybody got a pack of cigarettes I could borrow for a second? Anybody? Come on, you can admit it. I used to smoke. I like nicotine. All right, cool. Let me see that pack. Newport. Oh, is it menthols?
No.
Okay, I like menthols. Smell that cigarette. And my mouth actually starts watering. What is that?
Conditioning.
Classical conditioning, that's correct. It's actually watering. Now, Surgeon General's warning, smoking by pregnant women may result in fetal injury, premature birth, and low birth weight. Well, hell, I'm not a pregnant woman, so I can smoke. Right? It's a rather non-convincing message, right? It's going for a fear appeal. It's going to try to make me think, well, gosh, if those things could happen to an unborn, if that could happen to a fetus or cause birth defects, maybe it could be bad for me. But it's not directly stated that it's bad for me. And man, they taste good when you smoke them. If you don't smoke, they taste like shit. Right? Nobody ever took their first drag off a cigarette and went, that's tasty. Right? But they get that nicotine rush, and then they smoke and they're like, I can handle that. And before they know it, they're like, man, these are great. These are awesome. The habituation process, right? And the addiction process. And then they don't get a nicotine rush anymore. They get alleviation of nicotine withdrawal, and they get a lifestyle and a habit that goes with it and all kinds of other things that makes it really, really, really hard to quit it. As we saw before, about 5% or so of people who attempt the first time with no assistance whatsoever are successful. But yet nowadays, you can't get away from the message that it's bad for you. So you have dissonance, unpleasant tension state. I know it's unhealthy, but I smoke. So I can do one of two things to alleviate the tension. I can quit smoking or cut down maybe on smoking. And that would alleviate the tension between the behavior and the attitude. Because the attitude is hard to avoid, isn't it? Or you could change the attitude. You could actually care less. I can say, oh, research is not conclusive. I smoke cigarettes. I know people smoke to their 80s. You can use anecdotal reasoning. That's a smoker's lounge ceiling mural. That's not such a subtle message, is it? I wonder if they'll stop smoking now. Probably not. Canada has some very serious warning labels. They aren't subtle at all. They are in your face about the dangers of smoking. Some who seem reasonable about some things seem unreasonable about other things, but that's normal. Training and critical thinking is critical. So here we have a person, Roanoke Times, Melissa, worries about the effect on her unborn child from the sound of jackhammers. I don't know, man. Those jackhammers might be affecting my unborn child in a very negative way. But the cigarette smoking isn't? Fascinating, isn't it? She's actually concerned about her child. She's worried about an environmental hazard as she engages in hazardous behavior with regard to her unborn child. Right? Is that crazy? No, it's human. It's what human beings do. Because human beings have this almost limitless capacity to skew reality to make it more palatable. So here's an actual patient from the local clinic that I worked at and her rationalization for not quitting smoking. So she was asked by her physician, what do you see as the pros and the cons? That's the place you start. Obviously there's some pros or you wouldn't be doing it. If it was all cons, you'd probably quit, right? So there's some question. And the patient says, I see the benefits of quitting smoking include much improved health throughout her lifetime. Less aggravation of existing allergy symptoms. So I've already got a health problem that's made worse by this. Less sinus infections. Better health for my family members because I won't be exposing my kids to secondhand smoke. Elimination of smoking financial costs, which back then, $3 a pack, pack a day, it's $1,100 a year. And she was thinking, man, gym membership only costs $65 a month. I would actually net $300 or so, $400. Even with a gym membership, I'd still have more money in my pocket. These are all clear, compelling, logical reasons to quit smoking, right? This is what's owned by the patient. The patient themselves came up with the list. But everyone's got a bad habit. Smoking's better than drinking. Besides, I could die in a car wreck tomorrow. When it's my time to go, I'll go. Foof. Just like that. Cognitive dissonance. She knows this. She knows this. And she smokes. This makes that okay. The dissonance is alleviated by a shift in the attitude. I could actually quit and I'd be consistent with all of this. But if I can't quit, if I find myself challenged and it's very difficult to quit, then how am I going to live with myself knowing that I'm doing damage to my own health and maybe my own children's health, and I'm spending money I don't necessarily have to spare? You know what? Life is short. Oh well. I can just eradicate it as a tension state by changing my attitude. The attitude is the change there. This study, the classic study of Carl Festinger, of cognitive dissonance, it's a hard thing to prove. Now, that makes some sense to you. I can see that you could probably look at that example, and that makes sense. But something that just makes sense doesn't work for us in science. We have to prove it. To operationalize that and test it experimentally is difficult. That's a hard thing to wrap your head around. But Carl Smith and Festinger, 57 I believe it was, came up with a design that showed this in action, this principle in action. So a study of insufficient justification versus over justification. Participants were given either a dollar, back in that day that would be worth about $6 in today's values, or they were given $20, which would be worth about $120 today. This is an old study. So you imagine today you're in this study. You don't know you're in this study. You don't know the conditions of this study until you're in it. All you got to do is tell a little white lie. Now, most people like to see themselves as honest people, right? I'm an honest person, right? You think you're an honest person. Is there ever a time that you would lie?
Yes.
I would hope so, right? If you are hiding Anne Frank in your attic and the Nazis come and say, are you hiding a Jew in your attic? I would hope you would say, of course not. Why would I do that? That would be a benevolent lie, right? There's a real good moral reason to engage in what otherwise would be an immoral behavior, right? That's because ethics are debatable, that we have debates in ethics. The idea that we would just lie to people with no real moral reason to do so is repugnant to most people. We don't like people to lie to us. We are offended when people lie to us, are we not? You find out somebody told you a lie, you feel cheated. You feel like you might have to reevaluate that relationship, depending on how big the lie was. But a little white lie, interesting. So here's the thing. Puts people in a situation that is, by definition, boring. The situation is such that you are going to be brought in, you're given a board with pegs to turn. You turn the peg clockwise. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. The next row. And then you turn them all back. The task is designed to be monotonous, tedious, and unlikable. Right? You engage in a half an hour of tedious, monotonous, unlikable behavior. You don't know why. You're just in a study. You assume there's some purpose to this. And then they tell you, we have a person that usually meets our participants as they come in, and you're randomly assigned hereafter, that tells the participants that it's going to be an enjoyable task. We don't want people thinking that it's not enjoyable and not coming and the word getting out. So we have somebody we usually pay to tell them it's going to be an enjoyable, interesting learning experience or something to that effect. But that person didn't make it today. And we're wondering if you would do it for us. We'll pay you to do it. In some cases, they got paid $1, right? You were randomly assigned. Or you got paid $20. In other words, you were going to get the equivalent of $6 or $120 to just go into the other room and tell a person you think is another participant that what you just did and you know to be monotonous and boring is actually interesting and fun. Not hurting anybody, really, are you? They're already coming in to the study. And then after they do this, they're asked about their opinions of the study they were in. So as far as they know, this is just all regular, normal procedure. They get to the end of it, and they say, well, how enjoyable were these tasks? -5 to +5. How much did you learn? 0 to 10. How much scientific importance do you think this study has? 0 to 10. Would you likely participate in a similar experiment in the future? -5 to +5. And what you have here is a control group that didn't have to tell the lie. They weren't asked to tell a lie. So you get a rating of what people generally see this task to be. Then you got the $1 group and the $20 group. How enjoyable was it? -0.45. Neutral, actually slightly negative, right? How much did you learn? 3 on a scale of 1 to 10. How important? Neutral, 5.6. It must have some value or they wouldn't have us do it, right? Would you do it again? Neutral to slightly negative. Nah, I wouldn't want to do it again. But if you got $1 to lie, all of a sudden the tasks were significantly more enjoyable. Now, you didn't think they were any more knowledge-based, that you didn't learn anything more. You thought they were a little more important, but really, more importantly, check it out. You'd be more likely to do it again. You would do an experiment like this again. That's clearly the positive side of things. That's your attitude, isn't it? That's attitude being measured here. Behavior, you did a boring task, then you lied about it. Now would you do it again? Yeah, I think I would do it again. But look at the $20 people. They're no different than not getting paid, not being asked to tell a lie at all. They tell the truth to themselves. That's the key here. I have about equivalence there, 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 and there. In other words, if you paid me $120 to sell somebody a little white lie, I don't really have any cognitive dissonance. Who wouldn't tell a little white lie for $120? Doesn't hurt anybody. They're going to be here for 30 minutes. They're going to do it anyway. In other words, there's no inconsistency between the behavior of telling a white lie and my belief of myself as an honest person if you put $120 in the picture. But if I told you a lie for 6 measly bucks, now I have something's got to change. The behavior's not consistent. So what can I change? My attitude. I'll actually see the task as more interesting, right? That I learned more and it was more important. They changed their attitude. Yes, sir.
Were they aware that one group was getting only $1 and the other was
getting... No, actually nobody got paid in the end. So it was a real terrible thing for them. Yeah. They then explained that social psych research often is based on deception because if you told people what was really going on, they wouldn't behave in those ways, right? They would know what was going on. You'd get experimenter bias, you'd get participant bias. What they wanted was an unbiased look at what people would do under certain conditions. So in the end, nobody got paid to do it. But one group told a lie and thought they were going to get paid a lot. One group told a lie and thought they weren't going to get paid much at all. And the people who thought they weren't going to get paid much at all didn't feel good about that. So they actually changed their attitude so that it wasn't a lie anymore.
But the donor group, they'd be looking at it and be thinking, well, we can be able to pay more because these guys are
getting paid. They were unaware of the other groups. Yeah, they were not. They didn't know about the comparison. As far as they knew, they just were in an experiment. So everybody was then randomly assigned to those two groups. And yeah, so what you see is an actual clear-cut experiment where the behavior is inconsistent with a person's attitude. In one case, throw a lot of money in on it, and it's like, well, who wouldn't? So now I don't feel so bad about it. But in the other case, I'm not a liar. I just lied for almost nothing. But you know what? I didn't really lie. I really liked the experiment. I thought it was kind of interesting. So now it's fixed. Cognitive dissonance resolved.